Yat eh, welcome to Little Chase. Today we're gonna talk about the history of voting from an indigenous perspective because too many people are unaware of the barriers that Native Americans overcame on the path to suffrage. Look, I don't know about you, but us here at Little Chase, we didn't learn about this in school. A lot of this is new to us, but if you're like us and you wanna learn more, I highly recommend reading Native Vote by Daniel McCool. Jenna Bassett's Restricted Citizenship, and this report from Native American Rights Fund called Obstacles at Every Turn. So let's go beyond the classroom and dive a little bit deeper into this subject.
The right to vote in America began with white males who owned land, and states gradually expanded this right to include all white males. Then the 15th Amendment gave black males the right to vote in 1870. The 19th Amendment gave women the right to vote in 1920. But where do Native Americans fall into this timeline? Some natives were able to gain citizenship after the Dawes Act of 1887, but it came at a tremendous cost. You had to give up your culture and assimilate into white society. By 1924, through the Dawes Act and other methods, an estimated two-thirds of all Native Americans became citizens. Then the Indian Citizenship Act of 1924 granted citizenship to all Indians. It's important to note that not all Native Americans necessarily wanted that, but we'll get into that in another video. Much like the 15th Amendment for black men and the 19th Amendment for black women, the Indian Citizenship Act of 1924 didn't guarantee natives the right to vote. In Arizona, things started off okay. After the act passed, Arizona Attorney General John W. Murphy published his legal opinion regarding Indian citizenship in the Arizona Republic and on the subject whether natives had the right to vote. He said, "Being citizens, their right to vote cannot be abridged or impaired by state legislation, but such right is absolute." Basically, Murphy was reaffirming that Native Americans were citizens. And because they were citizens, their right to vote was absolute. But 4 years later, two Pima Indians, Peter Porter and Rudolph Johnson, tried to register to vote in Pinal County. But Maddie Hall, the county recorder, shut them down because they were Native Americans. This case went to the Arizona Supreme Court and was known as Porter v. Hall. What sucks is that Hall was represented by Murphy, who said the rights to vote for citizens was absolute, and they won. With some bogus argument. They said, "Native Americans are legally under federal guardianship based off the Supreme Court case Cherokee Nation v. Georgia, where John Marshall stated that the relationship between the federal government and tribes resembles that of a ward to his guardian. And Arizona's constitution states, no person under guardianship, non compos mentis, meaning not mentally competent or insane, shall be qualified to vote at any election. Therefore, Native Americans are ineligible to vote." The guardianship argument is demeaning and downright insulting because it suggests that Native Americans are incompetent to participate in the voting system. Unfortunately, with one broad stroke, Porter v. Hall enshrined the guardianship argument into law and prohibited all Native Americans from voting for the next 20 years.
What changed was the Native American soldiers who returned home from World War II. When they got back, they were fed up with the injustice. None of them were given the right to vote, including the Navajo code talkers, including Ira Hayes, who is from the same tribe and same community as Peter Porter. For Frank Harrison, a Marine and member of the Yavapai Nation, he saw how his parents were denied Social Security benefits under the same guardianship argument that kept his community from voting. So he and Harry Austin, his friend and his tribal chairman, they filed a lawsuit against the Maricopa County Registrar, Roger Levine. This case went to the Arizona Supreme Court, and the debate centered around the guardianship argument enshrined into law by Porter v. Hall. But this time, the court ruled in favor of Native American enfranchisements. They won, and the decision was unanimous. Justice Levi Stewart Udall, who supported Native suffrage when he was the Apache County Attorney, wrote the majority opinion and said, "In a democracy, suffrage is the most basic civil right, since its exercise is the chief means whereby other rights may be safeguarded. To deny the right to vote, where one is legally entitled to do so, is to do violence to the principles of freedom and equality." You know those old tropes where you think the hero finishes off the monster, but surprise, the monster's not dead? The ruling in Harrison v. Levine gave Native Americans the right to vote in Arizona. But it didn't dismantle the guardianship argument completely. Arizona continued denying old age assistance and Social Security benefits to Native Americans until Congress had to pass legislation to make this happen. Of course, Arizona then filed a lawsuit, but they lost. While all this was happening, there was another significant case in New Mexico called Trujillo v. Garley. There are important similarities and distinctions between the two cases, but we'll get into that later. For now, we want to give a shout out to our sponsors. Thank you to Instituto Movement Voter Project and Four Directions. In particular, thank you to Rainer Roanhorse for your support and guidance in this whole process. And if you're watching this video, you're probably the type of person who votes anyway, but double check to make sure that you're registered. There's voter purges all the time. Also, it's never a bad idea to create a plan to vote or to help others vote. We want natives to vote in 2020 in record numbers. So if you want more resources, check out our website, littlechase.com.